it's mm-hmm. like, yeah, I say to my co-producer,
this
my engineer,
is terrific.
I say to my co-producer and engineer, I say, you know that part in, whatever song, you know, Maggie May or something like that. Let's do a thing like that so it kind of has that same vibe, you know.
Well, you know, it's funny you should bring that up, because when we got Simon Says handed to us
wow.
as a record to record, it was done. They had tried it with another band, and it basically was flat. It wasn't going to happen. And we took it home to work on it, and we worked on it. It was still flat. And then I got this brilliant idea. I said, you know, let's steal from Wooly Bully, the bass part, and the organ going, dut, dut, dut,
yeah,
dut,
yeah.
Dut. That's what we did, and that's what made Simon Says happen.
You know, I do not hide my influences, man. I wear them right on my sleeve, you know.
Well,
and especially, like, this is not like a Ricky Byrd solo record per se. This is a it's making a statement, you know.
Sure.
So I had the luxury to be able to say, okay, you know, you'll get to a song called Lighthouse, or I could do it live, man, it's up to you. But
would you do it live?
Yeah.
I could do something live.
Do it live.
I could do that. So Lighthouse, I wrote a song that had like an Otis Redding vibe, because that was one of my, you know, him, Sam Cooke, you know.
Yeah.
But because this is not really a solo record, and there's no music business to speak of anyway, except for different, you know, not my kind of music, rock and roll, I said, all right, well, let's do it like, I've been loving you, you know, let's just do it like that.
So long.
Yeah, you know, and that's
for me to stop.
Maybe you and Frank could do a song together while you're here.
Well, I don't know if we know the same song.
You never know.
That could be a problem.
You know, but so that's the way I did this record. Like, I write this song and I'm going, you know, this reminds me kind of like a, you know, this kind of tune, or like a smoky tune or something. So let's kind of do it that way and use those. I don't care, man. It's just me giving a nod to the stuff I grew up on.
Okay. We'd like to get this clean Getaway on the radio. So.
That's a good one. Now, let me tell you who's on this guy. There was a band called Derek and the Dominoes that I grew up on, that Eric Clapton was in after he left Cream. And Bobby Whitlock was the keyboard player, played the B3. So about 6 months before I did this record, Bobby was doing a couple of gigs with his wife, Coco, and I was asked to do these two shows with them,
mm-hmm.
which was amazing because we did all these songs off of Layla. You know, I was playing Layla, man. I was like, wow, this is insane.
Mm-hmm.
You know, don't screw this up. This is like a real song. And Bobby was the keyboard player on all that stuff, right? He co-wrote like Bell Bottom Blues and all that stuff. So I got him to play on this. Like, wait till you hit the B3 on this, man. Bobby killed this.
Here it is. Let's hear it. WPAT.
I was 13 years old when I tasted my first high. I was 13 years old when I rolled up that first high. To the bottom, my life was stripped bare to the bone.